بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء. ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، أرسله بالحق بشيرًا ونذيرًا بين يدي الساعة. من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد، ومن يعصهما فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئًا. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولكل أمة جعلنا منسكا ليذكروا اسم الله عليه على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام، فإلهكم إله واحد فله أسلموا وبشر المخبتين. وقال تعالى: رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء. ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب. صدق الله العظيم. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. الحديث. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله. We begin praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send salat and salam upon our beloved master indeed Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his family, upon his companions, and whoever has followed their path until the day of Qiyamah. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us these precious days. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْدُودَاتٍ, that remember Allah on these counted days. The ulama have mentioned that أَيَّامٍ مَعْدُودَاتٍ is referring to يَوْمُ الْعِيدِ, that was yesterday, as well as أَيَّامُ التَّشْرِيقِ, that is the 3 days that follow Eid. So these are important days. That's why you will see that after the Fard Salah, we will read the Takbirat. And these are days to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us regarding these days, إِنَّهَا إِنَّ هَذِهِ الْأَيَّامِ أَيَّامُ أَكْلٍ وَشُرْبٍ وَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ, that these days of Tashriq, the days after of Eid and the days after Eid, these are days of eating, they are days of drinking, they are days of the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon all his favors, and we praise and we glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, we take this opportunity to congratulate the Hujjaj, those who have fulfilled one of the great pillars of Islam, the fifth pillar of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all the rituals, whether it be the tawaf, sa'i between Safa and Marwa, wearing of the ihram, pelting of the jamarat. These are all symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ, those are from the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whoever emulates and whoever glorifies and whoever gives respect to these symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the sign of taqwa in their heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the Hajj. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the opportunity to visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and also fulfill these great rituals of Islam. When we look at these times and we look at the aspects of Hajj, we remember none other than Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made Ibrahim alayhi salam a leader for us. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إن إبراهيم كان أمة قانتا لله حنيفا, that Ibrahim alayhi salam was an ummah. He himself was an ummah. He himself was like one nation because of all of the goodness that he himself contained. Allah describes him as an ummah. قانتا لله, He was obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was hanif. He was pure from any shirk. He did not worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His entire life was about glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and proclaiming the tawheed and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Today I would like to look at a dua that perhaps we all know. It is mentioned in the Quran. It is a dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, wherein Ibrahim alayhi salam makes this dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَا. That, oh my Lord, make me مقيم الصلاة. Make me one who establishes صلاة. This is one of the, if not the most emphasized action in our deen. It is something that a Muslim's life revolves around. We learn in the hadith, الصَّلَاةُ عِمَادُ الدِّينِ, that صلاة is the pillar of Islam. مَنْ تَرَكَ الصَّلَاةَ فَقَدْ كَفَرْ. That person who abandoned salah, he has committed disbelief, he has committed kufr. So we see that this is a very, very important aspect of our life. And this is why Ibrahim alayhi salam made this dua. رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ. Imagine on the day of Qiyamah, in Jahannam, one of the cries of the people of Jahannam will be, قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. We were not from those who perform salah. This is why when they will be burning in Jahannam, this will be their cry, that why didn't we perform our salah? Let us reflect upon ourselves. Let us make istighfar, let us make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding our deficiencies in salah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, that حَافِظُوا عَلَى الصَّلَوَاتِ وَالصَّلَاةِ الْوُسْطَى. That guard upon your salat as well as the middle salah. The ulama explained that guarding upon salah has many aspects. One is, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. That salah has been prescribed at specific times. We find how unfortunate it is that people who even perform their salah, they will delay their salah and delay their salah. A person will say that I'm out the whole day on work. When I come at night, Isha time, I'll read my qadha for dhuhr, asr, maghrib, Isha. This is not correct. This is a crime, this is a sin, this is a major sin in Islam. So, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مُنْقُوتًا. And we see from the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave attention to specific times. At specific salahs, he would make sure he would read it very early. At times, he would read it at a more appropriate time. So we consult with the books of hadith and the books of fiqh, we will see that every salah has a time frame, and on top of it, it has a preferred time within that frame. And this is part and parcel of our guarding of our salah. Let us ensure that we are reading our salah in the times that has been prescribed. Another aspect of our salah is we read it according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in a hadith that صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Perform salah as you see me performing salah. Alhamdulillah, Allah has given us a rich treasure of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that for 1400 years, it has been preserved, and the ulama have documented, the sahaba radiallahu anhum have documented the exact details of the salah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So everything in our salah, let us look to the sunnah. What was the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taught the ummah and taught the sahaba? And in that way, we establish our salah according to the sunnah and the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taught us. Another aspect is we should have humility in our salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Certainly the believers have succeeded. And the first quality of those believers, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who are humble in their salah. When they are standing in salah, they know that they are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked regarding ihsan, regarding excellence and perfection, what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه. That you worship Allah as if though you are seeing Him. فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. If it is not that you can see yourself seeing Him, so certainly He is watching you. You are conscious that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching me while I am performing my salah. So this was the first dua that Allah mentions in these ayah. رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي. Thereafter, Ibrahim alayhi salam doesn't only think about himself, but he says, and my progeny, and my offspring, my children. And this is a very important aspect that all of us need to take care of. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a responsibility and an amanah of our children, of our generation that will come after us, they will have to keep up and they will have to uphold this deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We see Allah speaks about it in the Quran, where even Anbiya alayhim salam on their deathbed, they had asked the question, what will happen after me? What will you worship? Who will you worship after me? And they waited for that answer, that the children confirmed that we will be upon Islam, we will be upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We find that in today's times, this aspect of looking after our children is a very big responsibility that we have. Because we know the society that we live in, there's lots and lots of invitations. The defense and the protection of our children has to become a priority in our life. Because Rasulullah ﷺ tells us that kullukum ra'in, all of you are shepherds. وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ All of you are answerable regarding his flock. So every person, whether it be a father, he has a responsibility over his family. Whether it be a mother, she has a responsibility over her children. Whether it be a person in a business, the hadith is open. So every person in a position of responsibility, he has to look after that responsibility because he will be questioned about it on the day of Qiyamah. I would like to just mention a few aspects that we need to take care of, especially in our times regarding our children. As parents, we need to give our children attention in the sense that we need to speak to them and give them that comfort at home where they know they don't have to look anywhere else. Because unfortunately, out in the world, there are many shayateen. And those shayateen are looking for our children. They are looking to make money out of them through selling them drugs. They are looking at them to take them away into entertainment and use them for other benefits that they see in the world. And in the process, they're going to lose their deen. So we as parents have to be serious about this. And we have to give priority to the tarbiyah and the nurturing of our children. Because in the nurturing of our children is the protection of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something which is a responsibility of every individual as a parent, as well as a community. We see young people amongst us, we see older people amongst us. Part of the qualities of the believers is Amar bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar. Therefore, this is a responsibility that we as parents need to take, and we need to ensure that we are looking after our children and we are giving them that attention at home that they don't need to look for anywhere else. Anytime somebody invites them to the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will remember that my parents told me that this is haram. My parents had advised me that Allah says this in the Quran, or Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned this in the hadith. If we don't give our children a strong grounding at home, then we will only have ourselves to blame if they go off the path of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the end, we can only try and we can make an effort. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who ultimately will give guidance. Another aspect of our children is their education. Unfortunately, today where everything in the world is about the dunya and it doesn't pass the dunya, and the greatest ham, the greatest worry of the people is the dunya and the education of the dunya, people will sacrifice the teaching of the Quran to their children. They will sacrifice the teaching of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and rather they will give their children everything of the dunya, every education, every skill, everything of the world, and they will think that this is the success. If we have to just look at the miserable life of the disbelievers, they do everything for their children's dunya. And when their children are grown up, their children don't care about them. Because they will look at their old parents and they will not say, رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا That, oh Allah, have mercy on my parents. They will say, this old person is a liability. Put him away in the old age home. Because they are trained in the dunya. They are trained to give importance to everything that they see as material. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us something greater. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum grew up in the time of jahiliyyah, a time that we referred to as ignorance. What changed them? It was the education of the kitab and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, when it comes to our children, the main education of our children is qala Allah and qala Rasul. If our child lives his entire life knowing what is the duties to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be successful. But if he lives his life knowing everything of the world, and that's why Allah tells us in the Quran regarding the disbelievers, يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِّنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا that they know the apparent of the dunya, وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ مُغَافِلُونَ But regarding the akhirah, they are heedless. They don't know nothing about it because the education is only about the dunya and that which will fill their bank balances, and they forget that which will fill their jannah with an investment. Another aspect regarding our children that we need to give a lot of attention to is the influence that our children have. Especially today, we have internet, we have cell phones, we have all of these devices. It is our responsibility to guard our children. And we'll find that many times people will say, no, I need to give my children these cell phones, I need to give them these devices, otherwise they will lose out in the world. Subhanallah, are we going to do this at the expense of the akhirah? We look at many adults. Adults are caught up with problems on their cell phone. They are committing haram day in and day out. How do we expect small children to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to guard themselves from all of these temptations? It is said to say that even today you will find children as small as 9 and 10 years old. They are addicted to pornography on their phone. Because we as parents, we have given it to them, they will not know what to do with it. And the shaitan and all of his agents will take them away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another aspect on these cell phones and all of these devices and the internet is we have these influences. The worst of shayateen, the musicians, the athletes, the actors, the comedians, all of these people whose day and night is revolving around zina and khamar. These are the people that are filled their life with haram, and these are the people that unfortunately every day our children are looking at them in their hands. So let us be parents of responsibility. Our children cannot handle it, don't give it to them. Don't feel shy or do not feel that this is an injustice to your children that they don't have a cell phone. If they have the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is your responsibility. If they are going to be put in a situation that will compromise the akhirah, don't be shy and don't hesitate to do that duty and take away those things which are haram. مَنْ رَآ مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ. This is a principle in Islam. We see something wrong, we need to remove it with our hands. Don't ever feel shy regarding this matter. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us of the du'as of Ibrahim alayhi salam. رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَا. Ibrahim alayhi salam makes du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, accept my du'a. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one that can accept. Thereafter, Ibrahim alayhi salam says, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ. That, oh my Lord, forgive me and forgive my parents and the believers on the day of reckoning. So we see that as the parents have a responsibility to their children, in a similar way, the children have a responsibility towards their parents. If we look in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made honoring of the parents one of the most important aspects of Islam. That our Jannah is dependent on the pleasure of our parents. We will be entered into Jannah because of the pleasure of our parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. After Allah mentions the aspect of tawheed and not making shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah then says, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Have kindness towards your parents. To this extent, do not say to them, لَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ. Do not say even the word uff. Uff in Arabic is a word of irritation, or when you are tired of something, you just say uff, uff, and you chase it away or you shun it away. To that extent, we don't say uff to our parents. وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. Let us lower the wings of mercy for them. Let us show them kindness. Let us show them compassion. Let us show them the greatest level of respect. Because after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is no other human being in this world that we have a greater obligation to than our parents. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned in a hadith, رِضَى الرَّبِّ فِي رِضَى الْوَالِدِ وَسَخَطُ الرَّبِّ فِي سَخَطِ الْوَالِدِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The pleasure of Allah is in the pleasure of your parent. The displeasure of Allah is in the displeasure of your parent. Therefore, this here is an important thing. And all of us as children, whether our parents are alive or whether our parents have passed away, remember that we will be answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding the rights of our parents. If our parents are alive, we make sure that we do everything
to make them happy and to please them. If our parents have passed away, then we make dua for them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. We go and visit their relatives. We keep contact with their friends. We make all of the necessary things that we can do in order to be dutiful to our parents. And thereafter, Ibrahim alayhi salam makes dua for waqfir lil mu'mineen, forgiveness for all of the believers. As an ummah, as followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should remember that we are part of an ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, after mentioning all of the anbiya alayhim as-salam, Allah mentions, inna hadhihi ummatukum ummatan wahidah. After mentioning all of the anbiya, Allah mentions, this is your ummah, one ummah. Know who we are. Unfortunately, today as Muslims, we have forgotten our identity. We are running behind the kuffar, thinking that they are going to give us izzah, thinking that they are going to give us respect, thinking that they are going to give us progression. But our progression, our honor, our dignity belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will give it to us when we turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as an ummah, we need to unite this ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. That hold firm to the rope of Allah, that is the Quran and the deen of Allah, jami'an, together. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And do not become scattered into groups. This tafarruq and this groups and camps between the Muslims is something which is totally haram, which is something which goes against the Quran. It goes against the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We see that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had passed away, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu, Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu, they went amongst the Ansar. Ansar were obviously the people who held the strength of the Muslims. They gave home to Islam. And they went and they had a meeting with them. And there was a suggestion that now that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has passed away, let us have two leaders, a leader from the Ansar and a leader from the Muhajirin. But the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar, said this is impossible. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to remain as one ummah. We do not divided in anything that we do. We are united in our approach and our way as a mu'min, as mu'mineen. So therefore, this unity of Islam, this unity of the Muslims, is something that we have to give a lot of attention to and ensure that we uphold the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala together, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us. A few aspects regarding this. As an ummah, we are faced with many challenges, obviously, in this world. We are faced with many fitnas. And it is important that we look after and we guard ourselves against these fitnas. Amongst these fitnas, we find that the disbelievers try and harm the deen of Allah. They try and desensitize us as Muslims to our deen. So they will kill us. They will take our blood. They will ridicule our deen. They will try and lure us to become like them. So this is something that we have to be ready for as Muslims, that we must identify what their fitnas are and we stay away from their fitnas, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has shown us a way, and Islam has given us heroes, that in order to defend our deen, we need to have qualities of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Many times people look at heroes and they look at people who are perhaps freedom fighters amongst the kuffar, or they will look at people who have accomplished in the dunya. These are not our role models. Our role models are the likes of Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. These are the people that we should look at and we should take our inspiration from, that how they stood up to protect the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This has to be our way. Another fitna that we as Muslims are faced with is this obsession with the dunya, that we love the dunya too much. And when we love the dunya too much, then we start focusing only on this world and all of its glitter and glamour. And even if it means us disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are willing to do it. Why? Because the dunya has become our greatest concern and our greatest want. This again, we find, especially in today's time of social media, where people constantly on their phones, they are being shown this new thing, this new car, this new house, this new thing. And people become in love with this world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, لا يغرنك تقلب الذين كفروا في البلاد. Don't let the movement of the disbelievers in the world deceive you. You will see the kuffar enjoying the world. You will see them having and moving here and doing this and doing everything. And we get attracted to this and we think that this is success. Look how successful they are. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, mata'un qaleelun. It is a small provision. It is a temporary enjoyment of the world. Why? Because ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir. The believer is the prison of the dunya is the prison of the believer, but is the paradise of the disbeliever. So let us not get deceived by what we see the kuffar enjoying of this world. If we have the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is sufficient. This year will get us to our destination of the akhirah. If we have the dunya, we don't have the dunya. It is not too much of a difference. Because we're not going to, this dunya is going to come to an end and all of that is over. But what we will take with us is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us ensure that this obsession of the world is out of our hearts. Because very often when we become obsessed of the world, then we break the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at a simple aspect like riba. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in the Quran that فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Be warned of a war from Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On the day of Qiyamah, people who are engaged in riba, in interest, they will be given weapons on the day of Qiyamah, right? Go and fight against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when we have love for this world, then what happens? We will, out of that love for this world, we will even engage in riba and go into riba transactions, thinking that our success lies in this. So this is all a sign of our excessive love of this world. And therefore we find Muslims, whether they are poor, whether they are wealthy, they are involved in riba in so many different ways, whether it be through banks, whether it be to loan sharks and all of these people that are offering you money and you pay back more later. This is all haram. And it is a sign of our excessive love of this world that will drive people towards this. Another aspect that we need to be conscious about and protect ourselves is all of these false ideologies. We see this last month there was a lot of talk about LGBT and all of these people who are doing the actions of Lut alayhi salam's people. This is a fitna for us. It is more than just a haram crime in itself. This is something that can take a person and will take a person out of the fold of Islam. Why? Because if a person believes that these are things which are acceptable and these are things which are haram, he has now, which are halal, he has now made halal what Allah has made haram. And according to the ulama are unanimous upon this. Any person who makes halal what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram is out of the fold of Islam. So this is a very great fitna that we as Muslims need to be very cautious about and we need to guard against. So we see the whole world is going towards this direction and talking about it. But as Muslims, if we know that this is haram, we need to be clear about it, we need to speak about it, and we need to protect our aqidah and our belief regarding these aspects. This is just one example, because it is more than this one example. It is about changing our mindset. When our mindset is changed, that look at the world and what the world wants us to do, we do, and what the world regards as right, we regard as right. No. We regard right what Allah has regarded right. We regard wrong what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has regarded wrong, because our worship only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In conclusion, we remind ourselves that we are an ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are following the way of the Anbiya alayhim salam. And especially during these days of Ayyamut Tashriq, these days of the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let us constantly remember Allah and think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And think about why Allah has put us in this world and where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is waiting for us in the akhirah. And let us renew our deen, let us renew our commitment to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will only do this when we are dedicated and devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum.